Now, may I invite Professor Lionel Ni, Chair Professor of Computer Science and Dean of Ing Tong Graduate School at the University of Science and Technology. The title of his talk, Never Stop Eating for Fear of Choking, From Snowden to Smart City.
Well, thank you. Well, it is certainly an honor to speak in front of all distinguished guests over here. And I'm sure you all know this guy. An unexpected visitor and hot potato to Hong Kong government. And I think last year, May, I think you know all about his stories. I think very important in Hong Kong, he revealed this top secret NSA called Prison Project. Get all the attention. What does Prison Project do? Well, some of you probably watched this movie, Batman, about Dark Knight. That movie talking about, you know, put something in your mobile phone, is able to detect your surroundings and then doing something. Sounds familiar, right? And the issue is, it's no longer science fiction. It's possible. You get all kind of information, try to find something. Actually, that's a Prison Project trying to do. They ask all the Microsoft, Google, Yahoo, all these big companies provide the needed data to NSA to detect terrorists. What they have is NSA has a phone logs of almost all US citizens. From this information, social network information, they can narrow down the search of the potential terrorists. And they claim they stopped 54 such potential attack. Well, you love Google. That's what I said many times. Google knows you better than you do. So many things you don't keep right now, but Google keep for you. Even better, remember, Google give you mailbox, 8 gigabytes free. So every once in a while, your Google website, some new service available, right? You can contact information using Google Drive to save your document, and using Google Drive to save your own mobile device information, and so many services available to you, and you truly believe free lunch is free, right? They are watching you, right? But to Google's point of view, they just make money from your data. Google, based on your data, can do personalized advertisement about how to make money. Even more, Google hired the most smart people in the world working for Google. You know about this. So, I mentioned the word big data. Probably read articles. Everybody talking about big data. I think the point is, what's big data? How to make sense of big data? Well, we get data. What we try to do is really using new technologies to find out the knowledge behind the data. That's what Google has been doing. But even more, we want to find out the insight in the data, something you don't even know. We call hidden knowledge. We can even do prediction from big data. That's get all attention. So this Snowden thing really get attention from all the people. Big data can do something we couldn't do before. Well, here, time constraint, I don't give you these are a few examples. Something couldn't do before now become possible because of big data. Okay. The middle one. This year, Nobel winner in physics is big data. They get a lot of data from CERN to prove the existence of so-called God's particle. Okay. And Google can predict or tell the trend of flu 2 weeks earlier than Center of Disease Control. How can they do? And as good as the CDC, okay? And you're using this, your cell phone. Siri does so good, right? You speak to Siri, they can recognize your voice, can do so many things which you couldn't do before. This all because of big data. Now, how does this have anything to do with smart cities? Talking about city here. Well, why need smart city? Okay. Well, we have urbanization problem, population problem, economic problem, all kind of problem. Basically, what's a smart city? In the mainland China, I serve on many we call expert panel to give advice on so-called smart city project. In the mainland, there are 311 cities from provincial down to district. In their 12-5 plan, smart city is a major agenda. Even I don't think the mayor knows what I mean by smart, but they are willing to invest. But to me, smart city is really big data can help they make better decision. Okay, I think my point over here is to a lot of people, when we say smart, what we mean by smart? To scientists, can we quantify smart? If I give you some RFID, certain device, can you claim that's smart? So basically, big data, we provide a better decision, okay? Here, I don't have time. Those are many applications powered by the big data in the smart cities, okay? From this, transportation problem, ventilation problem, so many things. What I want to share with you, what my team has been doing in the last few years. This all happened about 6 or 7 years ago. I served as a chief scientist for the mainland 1973 program, working on sensor network. So that work basically is try to collect data in the physical world as much as we can using different technologies. So at that time, I was able to access the data in the Shanghai. Well, this is not actually the picture, it's this in Hong Kong, but not in Hong Kong. In Shanghai, the Shanghai government required 6,000 taxis to put GPS inside a taxi. So basically, every taxi will report their location, at what time and where, the speed, and is the taxi occupied or not, the information every 30 seconds, about 6,000 taxis. So I was able to access 2 years such information. To the Shanghai government, wow, this is huge data. They only do simple statistics. But to me, it's like, wow, something's there. Something's there. Can we do something beyond the simple statistics? Now remember, 6,000 taxis in Shanghai only contribute 0.3% of all the vehicles in Shanghai. And taxi drivers have a different driving behavior, too. Can we do something from the data over there? And this first work, this in Shanghai, every spot over there is the location of a taxi at that time. Okay, black means it's vacant, red means occupied. Well, you may notice even a few taxis on top of Huangpu River. Well, the data is an error, of course. So we try to do is based on this taxi data, can we identify what we call hotspot? What do we mean by hotspot? That's the area, a lot of people, it's crowded. So we can do advertisement. I can save more money, put advertisement over there. Or can we do better scheduling for traffic? Or can we even detect some unscheduled event? More taxi doesn't imply it's more crowded. So somehow we're using a very smart approach, okay, to identify the hotspot in the Shanghai based on the data. Okay, I didn't work on data before. So 5, 6, 7 years ago, when I tried to convince my student working this area, he said, Professor Ni, well, you don't even know about this area. Well, I have trouble working on this area. But one student take gut working this area. He graduated one good paper. He get 2 offers, one from MIT, one from Carnegie Mellon. Okay. So well, all my students said, wow, that's the area to work on. Then we do even more. Okay. What this data can do? This is just one example. Another example is with this kind of data, how can it help urban planning? What we try to do is we find out we call most frequent paths from say A to B, find the most frequent paths. This will give you example for urban planning. Suppose from A to B, the CY is so good, spend the money, high speed low from A to B. But based on data we collect, you find out the most frequent path is not this high-speed low. It's the detour slow one. What's the reason behind this? Then find out, well, in the entrance and the exit, it's not well designed. is congested. So people try to avoid getting into. Now, you know, then you know how to solve the problem. Change entrance, change exit. Even more, how we do prediction. Even drive from here to airport, GPS tell you the shortest path or the path charge you the least, but doesn't tell you the current road condition, which is difficult to obtain. So this is our recent work. Based on the taxi driver's path, they are more experienced. They know where to drive. Based on all the path information in the past, we can predict the driving time for each road segment. We can predict at this moment, if you drive to airport, what's the best way to do? This is our most recent work over here. Get all attention, okay? All the work, you know, that's probably in the top venues in our area. Now, this is something, another example. The older people falling for detection. I was solving my mom's problem. My mom stayed with me. She's old. I worry about she may fall down anytime. I said, well, my mom put a sensor in your arm, your body. So you fall down, I can detect this. Well, older man, you're stubborn. She refused to do so. Now I said, I put a camera in her room. No, I don't want to be watched. She doesn't want the maid to stay with her all the time. So we think about, wow, how can I solve this problem? That challenge to my student group. Well, we do a sensing device. How can I solve this problem? Okay. My mom doesn't want to wear anything. Okay, she doesn't want camera. And I want to be quite accurate. Well, this is a new approach. We all know Wi-Fi device. We have AP everywhere, cheap, a few $100. So what we try to do is we put a few AP in my mom's room. Now, actually, when you change your gesture, you move, the signal change over there. We can detect the change of signals. But the problem is we try to distinguish when mice is walk, sleep, sit down, or fall down. Can you distinguish this? Very difficult problem. But somehow we find a way to detect all kinds of signals. And somehow, I work over a year, I can only get about 72% accurate. 72% means what? Useless. False alarm all the time, right? About 10 days ago, I worked with my colleague, Professor James Kwok, machine learning expert. I said, Professor Kwok, I have a problem. Can use the machine learning, big data analysis. So 10 days ago, I found out using the new approach, I can improve accuracy to 92% now. Okay, so we try to compete this year, ICT award. Another one project we're doing is you know, this Canton Tower. In China, we call Xiao Man Yao in Guangzhou City. That's a project we do in our Digital Life Research Center in the Four Indong Graduate School. What we try to do is you go to the Canton Tower, we develop a mobile app, put on cell phone. So we basically, we know where you are. We provide what we call location-based service. In other words, you reach floor, we give you direction. Now, even more, another thing, when you stand on the top of the Canton Tower, you look around the Guangzhou City, you point out, what's that building for? What's that building for? How can you tell? Now, this is our technology. You simply run our app, turn the mobile phone, video mode on. We will label for you. You click, you touch this building, boom, they tell you this is what, in about 3 to 4 seconds. Very difficult problem, because it's not simple, the image matching. The people may look from different angles, may look different. Using another machine learning approach behind this, we try to do. So by end of this month, you go to the Canton Tower, you will see our mobile app over there. Another one, shopping mall, we call smart shopping mall. Well, when you go to shopping, what you worry of the most? Where did I park? I forgot. Where's my wife? She's shopping somewhere, right? How do I get to that place? Okay, that's another app we do with Zhengjia Guangchang, the big shopping mall in the Guangzhou, which has more than 700 stores. So we develop app for them. Basically, go to over there. We remember where you park. And then we show your current location. Okay, we're even more. When you pass by certain store, you see advertisement, Professor Lee, come in. 50% off by what? Actually, trouble convinced me at the beginning. I said, look, you run this app, we can monitor your customer behavior. Once I have sufficient enough data about customers, just like Google, I can do personalized advertisement. I can make more money for store. They believe this. Okay, that's another example. Our technology makes sense. This is another one, air quality health index. You know this. In the China, about PM 2.5. Hong Kong last week said, well, we do more than PM 2.5. PM 2.5, we have AQHI. Well, too late. I smell bad air. What I try to do is, can you predict the air quality tomorrow in somewhere? Yeah, they have some simple prediction. In fact, our colleague Alexis and Jimmy over here, they do prediction using the mathematical model, run the supercomputer. I said, no, we have a better approach. You give me sufficient data in the past, I can predict better on the math model. Even better, if I have the traffic information, I have a mobile phone information, I can even do better. Now, talking about Google again, data center. A month ago, I put a joke, why Taiwan and Hong Kong won't have data center for Google? Well, somehow this happened, they decide to cancel the project in Hong Kong. I'm quite happy. Why, I was in Taiwan, or Singapore too, oh, sorry. Why you want Google put data center in your place? What did you get? From newspaper, what we get in Hong Kong? Income from real estate. Do we need the money? They only provide 25 low-tech jobs positions. And then power consumption. Now, data center only grow. You keep all there forever. That's where the value is. Google trouble put data center. That's the reason they put everywhere. Power consumption. It consumes a lot of power. The supercomputer center in Guangzhou, you know, world number one, electricity bill per year from 100 million to up to 300 million, just electricity bill alone. And what we cannot get? We can't get data. Google is not going to give data to Hong Kong government. They will say no to us, but they cannot say no to NSA. We don't even go call technologies. And but what government should do? I think government should collect more data to train more experts in this area. It's a high paid job, highly demand job in this area right now. Okay. I talked to Baidu, the executive vice president, Baidu Deep Learning Institute. Baidu in Beijing hired, the salary sent us in US, and then about double compared to other IT job right now. They couldn't find good people working in this area. I think very important, big data is a new type of infrastructure in smart cities. That's what government should do. Government should build a big data center to hold a job about important data, in, for example, the flow of people, taxi data, weather data, environmental data. And then they can benefit business, make more money from the data. Professor can do better research for provide better service to citizens over here. Certainly, there are many challenges as well, okay? How to collect and doing the data service, and again, privacy issue. I'm sure we'll ask about privacy issue. I've been working in computer science for over 35 years. I change my research every 5 years. We change too fast. I like my previous speaker said, you know, react to change very quick, otherwise I cannot survive. But big data to me is a new revolution. Something I didn't believe, I didn't even think about. But for the last few years, I think the revolution. We transform how we live, work, and think. The winner is the big data, will be those who has as much as possible data. The winner will be who can have a creative mind of what the data can do, not what value is. And the winner will be those who know how to extract knowledge and gain insight from data. And the winner will be we need computing resources to process huge amount of data. Actually, there are two key technologies. One is what we call deep learning, very hard term, okay, or called deep neural network. Okay, to do this, we need huge data to train this neural network, talking about millions, tens of millions, even billions of parameters. Otherwise, it won't work. And then you can tell we need the big supercomputers. That's what we are working on. Okay, working on Tianhe 2, okay, to solve our problem. So that's a never stop eating for fear of choking. Yes, privacy is a concern, but new technology do bring other concerns, as I mentioned, but we should face them and solve them, not escape from them. Technology will move the world forward, no way back. Can you think about, can work without cell phone, without internet? And the new policies and lawmakers have to catch up with the new technology advances. Or they're always behind. And the history has told us, those companies who overlook or ignore these new technologies will out of business faster than you thought. Hope you still remember Kodak. And big data certainly will make the cities even smarter. My last one, well, I believe big data is a strategic core competence. In the future, the power of a country is not how many nuclear weapons you have, it's your ability to collect data, to analyze data, find the insight. Hope Hong Kong doesn't miss this opportunity again. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ni, for your stimulating talk.